Today marks the 60th anniversary of Pacifica Radio. On April 15, 1949, at 3 p.m., a charismatic, conscientious objector named Lewis Hill sat before a microphone and said, "This is KPFA Berkeley." With that, KPFA went on the air, and the first listener-supported radio network in the United States was born. Pacifica Radio is the oldest independent media network in the country, and its 60th birthday comes as a deepening crisis engulfs mainstream media. Journalists are being laid off by the hundreds, even thousands. Venerable newspapers, some more than a century old, are being shut down. Commercial media are losing audience and advertising, and people are exploring new models for media, including nonprofit journalism. To commemorate the 60th anniversary of Pacifica Radio today, we bring you a documentary about the first Pacifica radio station, KPFA in Berkeley. It's called KPFA on the Air by filmmakers Veronica Selver and Sharon Wood. It's narrated by the Pulitzer Prize-winning author Alice Walker. It begins with Matthew Lasar, author of Pacifica Radio, The Rise of an Alternative Network.
I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that the people who started KPFA wanted to save the world. They'd been brought together by a charismatic pacifist named Lewis Hill, who'd spent most of World War II trying to figure out a way to end war. There was an enormous urgency in their minds to the creation of the Pacifica Foundation, because they believed that the world had gotten to the point where it could now kill people at a rate unheard of. And if there wasn't some response to that, by demonstrating that pacifism was possible, that it was really possible for people to resolve differences peaceably, that if someone didn't do that, the world would be destroyed.
In this year, 1942, we shall produce 60,000 planes.
Next Franklin
year,
Delano Roosevelt.
1943, we shall produce 125,000 airplanes, including 100,000 combat planes.
While most Americans joined the war against fascism, a small group of individuals took a different path. They followed the pacifist creed. There is no way to peace. Peace is the way. Their conviction set them apart politically. The government set them apart physically.
Roy Finch.
We were in a conscientious objector camp on the edge of the Sierra Mountains, about 6,000 feet up. We were stuck away just for the reason of not that we were not to be seen. So we were put in very isolated places. There were very few of us, you see, in that situation. The public was simply not aware of the existence of such a thing. One day, among the newcomers, I noticed somebody who really looked totally out of place. This guy looked as if he had just come from Abercrombie and Fitch or someplace like that, you know, where they sell expensive camping clothes. And I thought, my goodness, what has happened here? How did this fellow ever get here? Well, it turned out to be Lou Hill.
Lewis Hill defied expectations, even as a child. His parents had sent him to military boarding school, and he came out a pacifist. Now the government had sent him to a remote camp to silence him, and he began to think how he could bring pacifism to a mass audience.
I remember Lou saying something like this: imagine that you have a friend and you disagree with that person on some red-hot issue, and instead of just hating each other, that you sit down and you listen to what they say, and then he listens. I mean, that was the spirit in which we thought, open it up to everybody. Let's get this all on the table now, you know, and we were going to do this through the radio station.
Ever since he went away, wonder.
In 1943, Lou Hill received a medical release for spinal arthritis. He headed to Washington, D.C. to lobby on behalf of conscientious objectors. And with his radio idea in mind, he joined the world of network broadcasting.
My baby's coming home.
And now let me tell you about McTavish's skinless weenies. Mmm. So long.
He was appalled.
So flavor rich.
Commercial interests colored every program, even the news.
SO reporter bringing your last minute headline news.
Dear Roy, last night I resigned from the Blue Network. And I'm very glad to be out of that particular doldrum. In brief.
In letter after letter to Roy Finch, Hill elaborated his plan for a radically different kind of radio. One that promoted ideas, not products.
He had this idea, subscribe. Let the people themselves subscribe to the station and support it that way. And we were constantly arguing about it. Because I asked myself, would I send in money if I could get it free? And I had to say, maybe not. See, I didn't realize that the thing was going to be so valuable that people would pay for it even if they could get it free. You see, that's what I didn't catch on.
Hill waited until the war's end to move forward with his radio project.
Tell the nation my guys come back.
Newly married, he and his wife headed out to the one place where they thought it might succeed.
Joy Hill.
San Francisco was a very alive place to be at that point. There were ideas just floating in the air to be pulled out, it felt like. It was really quite exciting.
Small but fiercely cosmopolitan, the San Francisco Bay Area was a haven for utopian dreamers, blue-collar radicals, artists, and anarchists. Here, the poet Kenneth Rexroth presided over a freewheeling club of intellectuals calling themselves the Libertarian Circle.
Matthew Lazar.
And Lewis Hill immediately knew that he had to go to these people because most of them had been conscientious objectors, or almost all of them had been conscientious objectors during the war, and they were a very creative crowd. And he showed up unannounced one day at one of the Libertarian Circle meetings.
Eleanor McKinney.
It was at Richard Moore's house in San Francisco, his apartment. I believe it was an anarchist discussion with Kenneth Rexroth. And the place was packed.
Richard Moore.
I remember questioning Lou with an edge of contempt in my voice. I mean, radio is a ridiculous thing. This isn't political activity. Political activity is in the barricades. And as armchair anarchists, you know, that's a ridiculous thing to say, but it's, you know, that's what we said.
But Richard Moore was won over by Lou's vision that night, as was Eleanor McKinney, a young producer for NBC Radio. And with a few more recruits, they began the Pacifica Foundation in 1946, setting out, in Lou Hill's words, to create a Pacific world in our time.
Matthew
Hill
Lazar.
Began typing out, one after another, these little fundraising prospectuses. If you look at the early KPFA fundraising literature, it doesn't just talk about radio stations. It talks about starting magazines, schools. At one point, they were even talking about a chain of restaurants. They saw themselves as part of a mass world movement for a peaceable world.
After 3 years, they'd raised less than half the money they'd hoped for. But on April 15, 1949, undeterred, they gathered in their makeshift studio for the first day of broadcasting.
Eleanor McKinney.
We didn't feel it was real. I mean, you do all this work and raise the money and make a decision to start it on a shoestring. And that day, everything was at last minute till on the air. And then Lou stepped up to the microphone, and it moved us all.
In time past, many romantic feelings were associated with radio broadcasting. But KPFA itself is a real place only a few steps up from the street, an instrument for real thought and serious intercourse, an integrating aspect of the community.
Denied an AM license, they had to settle for FM, which very few radios received in 1949. And KPFA's signal barely reached the Berkeley city limits. It was not Lou Hill's grand vision, but it was a start.
Two of the world's leading scientists have agreed to debate the issue of fallout and disarmament. Each will speak from personal convictions based upon experience.